Hello, everybody. We're here in the Church of St. Verena and Three Holy Youth. We're going to give a very nice discussion together about a very important event in history. Can you guess what it is? From the way the Church looks now, it was all white. Look at the curtain of the altar. Let's look at this icon. We all know what this is, right? It's the icon of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we see the Church all white because this is how our Lord overcame death, is that he resurrected from the death after he was crucified. The resurrection. And the crucifixion. Okay, you're maybe dizzy now because of the moving of the camera, but we're going to get together and answer a very important question. If somebody asks you, how do you know that Jesus is crucified and resurrected? What would you say? You would tell him, the Bible says so. He says, of course the Bible will say so. Do you have any other proof that Jesus existed and that he resurrected? And please, not from the Bible, because the Bible is your book. I need something else. So let's get together and by God's guidance, answer this question. Here is a PowerPoint that will help us to answer this question from outside the Bible. This is very new, is to learn how to give an answer to anyone who asks this question and work with the person. In 1 Peter 3:15, the Bible tells us, love Christ from all your heart. Revere Christ. Be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks you about the reason for the hope that's in you. And do this in reverence and meekness, not with a fight. Even with the person coming to fight and mocking and making fun. So let's see. Did Jesus exist as a person? We know the Bible says it does. Did he rise from the dead? Can we use another way to defend this from outside the Bible? These are the questions that we get asked, maybe not when we're very young by friends, but that we get older, they challenge, how do you know this is right? When we celebrate Easter, they tease us, oh, how do you know this is true? How do you know the Bible is true? And we're going to use here something else other than the Bible to tell us that there is Jesus. And with using our mind, we'll be able to see that he also resurrected. So did Jesus rise from the dead? Did Jesus exist? How can I answer, my friends? The resurrection is the most important event of Christianity. Why? Because if Jesus resurrected from the dead, then he is God, because nobody can resurrect himself from the dead. Only God, because God never dies. When he died, became human and died, if he can raise himself, which is the resurrection, then he is God. So it does two things. It shows us that God exists, and it shows us that there is another life. So number two, that I also will be raised and not see eternal death. So when I die as a holy person who is with God, I go to Jesus, who resurrected and prepared the place for me. So is there any way we can know that Jesus existed and that he resurrected without using the Bible? Let's learn together. Yes, we can use history. History of different types of people. Because you're young now, I can't tell you the different types of people, but we're going to use one very important type today, and it will help us more in our case. We shall use history in a smart way. How? History can tell us about people who are not Christians at all, that in the writings, they mention about Jesus. So that's from outside the Bible. Do historians have good things to say about Jesus or people who write about him? Usually not, which even helps us more. Do they say nice things about Jesus? No, they don't. This makes it more believable, because if they say nice things, then they are also probably lying, if we assume that they are not telling the truth. But the fact is that they were going to use people who make fun of Jesus and make fun of the people who follow Jesus. But with their words, what they wrote for us as making fun, they will prove to us that Jesus is there, existed, and he had people who are following him, and we're going to see how these people behave. So from the writings of those who make fun of them. So they don't say nice things about Jesus or the Christians. This makes it more believable because they are not biased. Biased means that they are taking one side, the side of the Christians, and actually they are taking the opposite side of the Christians. So it makes it more important for us to know the writings. How about we use people who make fun of Christians, which is one example we're going to use today. This is a great way to show that Jesus existed in history and that he had people following him. So how does it work? Here is how. When people make fun of the Christians, this means that these people who are making fun are not Christians, and therefore they do not believe in Christianity. So they are not going to support Christianity. They're going to say things against it. So what they say is not because they want to preach Christianity, but on the opposite, they make fun of it. So we shall use this making fun of Christians to prove that Jesus and Christianity, the people who followed him, existed, and will prove also that he resurrected from what they say. One of these people is Lucian. He lived in the second century. Second century means in the year 100 something AD. So he's a satirist. Satire means to make fun of a situation. People, comedians, they take a situation from life and they make it funny. That's what a satirist is. He lived in the second century. And remember, that's very short after this Christianity started, which is in the first century, because the man, the Lord Jesus Christ, was crucified in 33 AD. So what does he make fun of? He makes fun of two things in his writings. Of what Christians believe in, and two, they make fun of how Christians behave. I'm going to see this now. So third and fourth, we'll go to the conclusion slide afterwards when we cover a certain part, and fifth and sixth, we'll keep going. So here, we'll take this for everybody. Lucian has two passages we're going to discuss. The Christians, here is what he writes as making fun of the Christians. The Christians, you know, worship a man to this day, the distinguished personage. We're going to explain every sentence. Who introduced their novel rites and was crucified on that account. You see, these misguided creatures start with the general conviction that they're all immortal for all time, which explains the contempt of death and the voluntary self-devotion, which are so common among them. Let's read the passage again. Lucian is writing as making fun of these people called Christians. The Christians, you know, worship a man to this day, the distinguished personage who introduced their novel rites and was crucified on that account. You see, these misguided creatures start with the general conviction that they are immortal for all time, which explains the contempt of death and voluntary self-devotion, which are so common among them. Don't worry, we're going to explain every sentence and we'll make it easy. First sentence, the Christians, you know, worship a man to this day. This man that he refers to is Jesus, because it's known that the Christians worship this man, Jesus. This tells us also that there were a group of people called the Christians. So in his writing, when he says the Christians, you know, worship a man to this day, this tells us, a proof to us, that there is a certain group of people called the Christians. And we know that these Christians say that the man Jesus is their God. So he's making fun of this. And it also tells us that Jesus was worshipped by the Christians. So this first sentence, the Christians, you know, worship a man to this day, tells us three facts. This man is Jesus, that this man is worshipped by the Christians, and that there's a group of people called Christians. And was crucified on that account. That is a very important statement. It's not in the Bible. We're reading the writing of somebody who makes fun of the Christians, called Lucian, or Lucianus in Greek. He says he was crucified. So when somebody says, how do we know he was crucified? And we say, we don't have to use the Bible. There are so many writings. This is one example of tens of writings of other people that mention the fact that Jesus was crucified. This is very, very important that someone who is not Christian and in fact makes fun of the Christians is telling us a fact that Jesus was crucified, or the man Jesus was crucified. So no one can tell us that he was not crucified. If somebody tells you he didn't exist or he was not crucified, then this person didn't read anything. Let's continue. And we are not using the Bible here. We are using Lucianus or Lucian. On that account means Lucian understands that Jesus taught his followers certain teachings, and because of these teachings, he got crucified. We're not going to discuss whether he's right or wrong. This is how he understands about this group of the Christians. They followed a certain man who was crucified, and he was crucified because of telling them new things. Following, we shall see from what Lucian wrote that the Christians have certain rules, as we keep reading. So, you see, these misguided creatures start with the general conviction that they are immortal for all time. Lucian does not like the Christians. That's why he calls them misguided creatures, crazy people. They don't know where they're going. They don't know what they are doing because they follow a crucified person. Who's the crazy that follows a crucified person and calls him God? So this is to our advantage because the writer is a person who's making fun. But as he's writing, we see facts about the life he's talking about, his environment, about what's surrounding him. And what's surrounding him is these Christians and their teachings. And now, from outside the Bible, we're seeing this. So it's very important to see that he's calling the Christians misguided creatures, crazy people, that they follow a crucified man. These two lines tell us that these followers of the crucified Jesus believe that they are immortal. They will not die. Immortal means that they will not die ever. Conviction. Okay, let's take it word by word. You see these misguided creatures start their first belief is the general conviction. They are convinced, they believe that they will not die. They are immortal for all time. So he makes fun of this. But it tells us what the Christians that he observed are believing in. And he continues, this, which explains the contempt of death and voluntary self-devotion, which are so common among them. Contempt of death, to be contemptuous of something or to have contempt for something means that you laugh at it. You don't give it much attention. If you're not in respect of court, for example, the judge will say, I will hold you in contempt. Like you did not apply what I ruled. You did not care about it. So he says that these people, they think they are immortal, they will never die, and that's why they have contempt of death. They are not afraid of death. They laugh at death. So this belief explains why these misguided creatures are not afraid of death. Taban, he calls us crazy. And voluntary self-devotion. So let's explain contempt of death first. Means that they are not afraid of death. So this means that Lucian is telling us that because these Christians believe that they will live forever, they are not afraid of death. This matches why we hear about the martyrs, that they were even singing hymns as they go to death. From other historians who write about history, there's other historians that tell us that martyrs were singing as they go to death. And this is very, very important. As we say that we can understand it from outside the Bible, from history. Continuing the same passage. So we cover contempt of death. You are not afraid of death. He describes them as not afraid of death. Voluntary self-division. Voluntary means you do something on your own. Nobody pushes you to it. Self-devotion, devotion means I'm like morning devotion, that every day I have a quiet time with God, my morning devotion. Self-devotion, that from their own, they are devoting themselves to time with God, to relationship with their God. This statement means that they are spiritual people on their own, without someone pushing them, and without them pushing someone else. They did not persecute people who did not follow them. So common among them means this is the natural everyday life, and this is very spread among them. This means that this is the way they behave always. So far, the third and fourth grade will stop here, but the fifth and sixth, because they can take another passage and understand it, we're going to keep going. So, the total conclusion, based on these two passages, or even based on the first one, which is for third and fourth grade, and based on both of them for the fifth and sixth. The resurrection is true because according to Lucian's description of the followers of Jesus, as he makes fun of the whole thing, number one, the followers of Jesus were not afraid of death. If you get a group of people who follow a crucified dead person, and based on this, they are not afraid of death, then this person must have resurrected. If he hasn't, then why would you follow a corpse? Why would you follow a dead person dead? And their behavior reflects it. The followers of Jesus, number two, were not seeking any worldly belongings, as they behaved as brothers and loved everyone. Additional proof, if Jesus did not resurrect, then who made up this story? The disciples. Somehow, he didn't resurrect, and they invented, oh, he resurrected and we saw him. Then the disciples are liars. If Jesus did not resurrect, the only people who would make up the story that he resurrected would be his disciples. And in this case, they are liars because he didn't resurrect and they claim he did. And they are preached that he resurrected, and they died confessing that he did. So if I lie about something, I would not die for that something. Let's say it again. If I know that what I'm preaching is a lie, I know it's a lie, I made it up, and I'm threatened to change my opinion or to die, I would not die. I will change my opinion because I would not die for something I know it's a lie. And that is exactly what the disciples did not do. They said, we'll go to death because we're sure of the resurrection. And not only one, and not only two. We have 12 disciples. Matthias was chosen instead of Judas. And we have 70 apostles, plus St. Paul also. We have about 83 people who have the same mindset. And they did not get rich. They did not get wealthy. They were persecuted by the Jews, by the Greeks making fun of them. This is an example. And by the Romans for 300 years trying to kill them. From Nero till Diocletianus or Diocletian. So once they started preaching, everything was against them. And how come this faith didn't disappear? Jews are persecuting them. Greeks are making fun of them. Romans are killing them in martyrdom. So this shows very much that the resurrection must be true, because it cannot be a mass 82 people or 83 people started by saying we saw him and they didn't, and they all die for it. Nobody dies for a lie that he makes up. Maybe in other religions it started by somebody who claimed I saw him, but they believed that person and they continued in death. But the original person made up something. Here we have not one person, we have 83, all agree on one thing, and they all say we saw him. And even in St. Paul's epistle, but I'm not using the Bible here, in 1 Corinthians 15 says 500 people saw him in one time. But I'm seeing here our curriculum today is to do it from outside the Bible, so by logic. So if he did not resurrect, and all of the 83 say that we saw him, then we have 83 liars. 83 liars, they might have make something profitable for them out of this lie, gain money, gain power, gain ruling in a kingdom on earth. They have to, people make up a lie in order to get something to themselves, or make up even a religion in order to get power, to get people to follow them. Christianity is not like this. Christianity is all about leaving the world, leaving the power in the world, leaving the belongings of the world. And we have our examples as the people who said Jesus resurrected, the disciples and the apostles, all of them died in martyrdom, owning nothing. So they preached that he resurrected and they died confessing that he did, with no belongings, with no richness, all tortured from city to city. So if Jesus did not resurrect, then they made up the story. But this is illogical, for they all died confessing that he resurrected, and no one dies for something that he himself made up. With this, I leave you asking for your prayers, and please try to study and enjoy this logical thinking, that our faith is not blind and we can defend it by thinking. And we use today a method that's outside the Bible to show that Jesus existed, he had followers, what were their behavior, and they believed in him and they followed him till death, and they were not afraid of death, which means that he must have resurrected. Otherwise, it would be so strange to die like this. Thank you all very much, and glory to God the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. E Christos en Esti.